had a lot of the place, but there was a street light, I don't know how many hundred yards away it is, but there's a certain chink in my curtains at night, that if those curtains aren't closed properly, the way I lie in bed, if I'm under a certain angle, the light shines in, and there's nothing worse than sleep deprivation than permanent lighting. I know people have to have blackout curtains, and even that keeps them awake. And so, from a personal point of view, I wouldn't like to have anything illuminated throughout the night that might disturb my sleep. But secondly, I can't understand why a block of flats has to be illuminated through the night. I can understand security lights coming on and that we're going to be able to get people might walk for security reasons, but not to have them on a block of flats for aesthetic reasons, just blowing them away.
Can I ask the environmental officer to make some comments on this? I believe that it's the 6th and the 9th floor that the lighting is on, is that correct?
Well, through you, Chair. Yes. When this application came in, an officer visited to assess the orientation of the lights to try and determine whether it's going to cause any light nuisance. What we look at there is quite specific, whether there's any lights that are going to shine into the property directly. On the officer's advice, the ones were mended, so the lights shine up the building and not down into people's gardens and windows. I need to distinguish at this point between light nuisance, not shining into your window, and what's commonly called perhaps light pollution, where you might have, which again is a subjective term, but where you might have more illumination and spillage of light and reflected light than you might want or find attractive or desirable. Now that's something that we don't have any power over and haven't commented on the aesthetics actually of the flat. So we've looked at light nuisance, but we haven't taken into consideration just the aesthetics of having that flight, about those flats illuminated, which are two perhaps slightly different things, if that helps.
Okay, I think in the report, if you're looking at page 49, under appearance of amenity, second paragraph, last comments, it says, it is therefore considered that the proposed floodlighting will have minimal impact on neighbouring occupiers' amenity in regard to potential light disturbance. So, by the fact it says minimal impact, registers to me that we'll have some impact. And I think that we've heard from Chris Origin to say that he believes it is having an impact on residents. Okay, so that's my point of view on that. Sorry, Denise.
Yeah, and Eugene. I was just wondering if they could not put a timer on them or something, if they're going to keep them on. Because in the summer they wouldn't need them on anyway. In the winter months, maybe they could go off at maybe 9 or 10 o'clock at night. Not to disturb. Because obviously they still have an impact on the neighbours.
I'm unclear from this report whether they do stay on all night. Can we have some comments?
My children go to sleep at 7 at night. They're 2 and 4.
Thank you. Through you, Chair. I don't know what the times of the nights are. We've made an assessment of their actual position and whether they're going to cause any direct light nuisance, but we haven't made an assessment on the appearance of the flats and the general illumination. And so I don't know what the actual timings the flats are.
Have we got anything put in any papers at all to say?
Chair, I may have missed something here. Can somebody explain to me why they want to illuminate this building? the need for that in the first place.
But I assume when you put in a planning application for something that you don't know how to say why we want to do something, so... I'm sure we were sort of fascinated over a number of things that we have through this committee. So, Stuart, did you want to speak?
Sorry, Chair, yeah, it was to agree that my assessment of it is similar to yours now, the slight nuisance that I might be concerned too much. I take the Environment Health Officer's definitions of light nuisance and light pollution. Just common reading, the council seems to have gone out of its way in terms of the new lighting that it's installed to ensure that there is no light pollution so far as the sky is concerned, and maybe we'll reach a point in a number of years where we can see the stars again because there'll be a lot. Council Clare, I'm not going to collect credit for this, Council Clare whispered in my ear earlier about the singular waste of energy actually that drugs like this puts on the environment. I assume that this is white light as well, which by its very nature is a nuisance.
Is it white light? Do
we
know?
Through Chair, I don't have the details of what kind of light it is.
Okay, I think we're in a position here where we can either refuse this application or we could attach additional conditions. So we could have that this light is switched off at a certain point, or we can refuse the application or approve the application as a case may be. So, does anybody have any other comments? Does anybody want to move refusal? Does anybody want to add an additional condition? Thank you.
Well, could we... Is it possible to get advice from officers on the possible wording of a condition that would limit the hours when the lights would be allowed to be on?
Properties could easily expect to enjoy.
I'll second that, Jim.
Okay, the officers are suggesting we take out the word adjoining in respect of that. So,
Surrounding.
Okay, so are you happy with that amendment to surrounding rather than adjoining? All right, so Stuart's moved it, Denise has seconded it, all those in favour, subject to conditions. All those in favour of refusal.
Do we need a clause, Chair?
Okay, that's unanimous. Okay, so that application was refused, Mr. Torrey. Okay, members, we're now going to go to agenda. Are we finished here? We're now going to go to agenda item 11, which is pages 69 to 72, 13, Fenton Way. Can I have the presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This proposal is for a dog hotel and daycare within an industrial unit in Prenton Way. The proposed use is a sui generis use, so it's not classified in the use class order. And it's more important, it's not an industrial use, therefore this proposal departs from the UDP, because this is a primarily industrial area. There are a number of vacant units on this industrial estate, including this one subject to the application. The proposed use will bring the unit back into some use and will create 6 jobs in total. There is a practical reason for locating the dog care hotel at this location, because it's close to an existing business run by the applicant. And furthermore, the proposed use, it wouldn't be compatible in a lot of areas, such as commercial area in the Greenbelt would be acceptable using a residential area. So it goes to stands to some sort of reason that it's an acceptable, appropriate use in this industrial area. There are conditions proposed to ensure that the units are returned to an industrial use should this use cease, and it's also given a temporary permission for 10 years. So if it's not used, it will revert back to an industrial use, and on that basis it's recommended for approval.
I'm happy to move approval.
Okay, Steve, take the comment first.
Perhaps some people remember the application that has been submitted by Greenfields on the Mells Road.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't see any mention in here of compliance with the council's new kennel standards that would have to apply. And I'm not sure within those kennel standards there is a need for an outside run of any description and so on. So before I could approve this, it would have to have some reference to us having spoken to the other relevant departments that all those standards will be met. And I'm hoping the applicants have been informed that all those standards have been met before we allow dogs, because animal welfare is a massive issue. So I'll also be assured before that goes on this subject.
Okay, thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Honourable Chair. The applicant has met with officers to discuss animal health. The animal health licensing officer has visited and been extensive discussions, so they're aware of the new council requirements. It would require a council licence and be subject to inspection. And there's also been discussions with animal health from Andoni's point of view.
Okay. We have that as an informative note. I know sometimes we have these informatives to allow people the statutory requirements, particularly around highways. And as Steve's raised, that he's an important issue. It probably needs to be reflected in the minute as well.
Okay, thank you.
or something to add it to an informative to Cognizant Planning.
Okay, I think that's a reasonable suggestion, Susan. Thank you, Steve, for raising that. Denise?
Yeah, this is my ward chair, Quentin, and I know the industrial estate really, really well, so anything that's going to use another unit up is a brilliant idea. But I think it's really refreshing having a dog house as a dog owner. I was looking for somewhere for my dog to go, because nobody wants them. But I wish the applicants good luck in their new venture. And hopefully they might see a little bit more of me down there. Thanks, yeah. And I'll be seconding with David.
Okay, are there any other comments before I move on? Okay, David, you first.
Yes,
Denise, you seconded it. All those in favour of the application? Subject to the conditions listed.
Yeah.
Are the amendments?
Yes.
No. Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you. Okay, members, we are juggling a little here, but we're now back to agenda item 6, which is pages 33 to 40 in your packs. And we have a presentation, please.
Thank you, Chair. This application relates to a 42 Cavendish Drive, and it was considered at committee in January. It's for a rear extension. It is a retrospective application because the rear extension has more or less been completed. There was concern and objection received for the application and expressed at the committee meeting over the state of the site, and it was committee resolved to impose a condition to limit the permission for 12 months with a view for the applicant to tidy the site within this timescale. This has subsequently been reviewed by officers and discussions have been had. There are national guidance again related to the imposition of planning conditions, states 6 tests. And the 6 tests, I'll just read them out quickly. They have to be necessary, relevant to planning, relevant to the development to be permitted, enforceable, precise and reasonable. We've had a look at the condition, and normally we impose a time commencement condition in line with the national guidance. This is a standard condition that we put on to most applications. This is a retrospective application, so we can't impose that condition in this instance. The National Planning Policy Guidance that we write and draft our planning conditions, there isn't an inclusion for any development to be completed within a particular time scale. So therefore we can't enforce a condition of this nature. So the condition that was proposed at committee in January was a temporary permission. Now we only usually impose a temporary permission to a use that we're not happy with, that we want to see how it goes along, and then we can look at a permanent use or a temporary building. This doesn't fall into either of those categories. Therefore, it's unreasonable, it's unnecessary, and it's not enforceable. So from that point of view, we're asking members to look at the application as it's submitted for the retention of the extension with the condition, without that condition that was discussed at the committee in January. Just to update committee, officers have been meeting with the applicant, so there's various officers been involved, and the site has been tidied up somewhat from the pictures and the photographs that we had last time in January. So those discussions will be ongoing and will encourage the applicants and the site owner to keep the state of the land tidy, but we can't do that by condition, so we're asking if it can be approved as per the report.
Stuart?
This is why I always listen to I've had calls, having read this, I did go on to the government's .gov.uk guidance use of planning conditions website. And there's a whole chapter there on conditions relating to time limits, and suggested the standard condition is indeed 3 years. But then it goes on to say, the local planning authority may wish to consider whether a variation of the time period could assist in the delivery of development. It gives an example. A shorter time period may be appropriate where it would encourage the commencement of development and non-commencement has previously had negative impacts. Now, the discussion and the debate we had, having heard from the ward council, was that there were clear negative impacts to the neighbours of this property. And when we were, you know, seeking to try to find a form or condition of some sort that could mitigate against those negative impacts, the suggestion that I made was to limit the time limit. I wasn't aware at that point that actually that was the exact example that was given on the government guidance website. So, as well as having reconsidered it myself, having read the example on the government website, I still consider that a shorter time period would justify limits, given the evidence that we had at the last committee of the negative impact that the development was having on the community. So, I'm not sure how my vote ought to be cast or what I ought to do, but I am content with the permission and the conditions that we set as a committee in January. That's my observation.
Okay, Stuart, I'm just going to ask the solicitor to make a comment on that, and then I'm going to ask the officer to come in with her comment, okay?
The condition
which
was approved at the last committee was in January, it was that the development hereby permitted shall be limited to a period of 12 months. That would mean that after 12 months, that development did not have planning permission and therefore would have to be then subject to enforcement action to actually remove the development. Now, when you're talking about a retrospective planning application for a building that's already been built, it's considered that that is not a reasonable condition. Because you would then be, we wouldn't normally say that a building can be built that it only has planning permission for a particular length of time. It's not a reasonable condition.
I think one of the questions that I'd asked of officers is how far on are they with this build? And as a guess, I was given an estimation of 60% built. So does that still apply?
We would still be in a position where we're limiting. Normally you would limit, for example, a site where something was being put on the land that could be removed, and then you would say that it had to be removed within a certain period. That would be the standard situation where you would limit a time, not to a permanent development, whether of an extension, to say you've got it, permission for that extension for a set period of time, would mean that at the end of that period they have no time of permission for that development. Which is not a reasonable position to place a developer in, because effectively we would then have to take enforcement action, having given them that information, to then remove the building.
Okay,
would you
like to add to that?
Yeah, through you, the guidance that Councillor Kelly refers to talks about the commencement of development, so that standard condition talks about that development has to be started. This has been started. The variation in the 3 years is where we're giving the developer a more reasonable time frame to start the development, so it's not applicable in this case. I'll just read out some of the guidance again. Sorry, to John. The guidance that you refer to goes on to say what approach should be taken to imposing conditions, and then goes on to say that are there any circumstances where planning conditions should not be used. And in this instance, conditions requiring the development to be carried out in its entirety is an unreasonable condition, and it will fail the test of necessity by requiring more than is needed to deal with the problem they are designed to solve. Such a condition is also likely to be difficult to enforce due to the range of external factors that can influence a decision whether or not to carry out and complete a development. So it fails on the necessity aspect as well.
Okay, and just in terms of for comment from the environmental officer, obviously you've been out to the site. Is this a site that you will be continuing to monitor?
Thank you, through you, Chair. Yeah, we've visited with colleagues in planning enforcement. We arranged to meet the owner, well, the owner's representative being involved on site, to discuss the conditions. When we got there, the site had been significantly tidied up. Explain the benefits of keeping it tidy. to some neighbours that it should deteriorate, they should let us know straight away, and we will take that on board with the owners.
Okay, are there any other comments?
No, I think we should actually realise that the professional officers know their work, know the law, know their rules, and we are effectively amateurs, and we can, you know, guide them, use their assistance to get a result. There are vacancies in the department, and I suggest Stuart and to pass the first stage of the minimum criteria to be a finance officer. And then we can move on from there. So my view is that we are where we are in this situation. We have to accept the professional advice and we've approved.
Do we have a second to that, Denise? All those in favour of approval subject to the conditions listed? Those against? Okay, that's carried. Thank you. We're nearly there, folks. We're now moving on to agenda item 12, which is pages 73 to 78 of the packs. Can we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This is a site on Rendering West Kirby. It has previously been a bar, restaurant, cafe use, and it's now being to be used as a Costa. So the proposal is 200 adverts. There are existing fascia and board signs at the site. The proposal is to replace the fascia signs, replace the freestanding board sign at the front of the site, and the hanging sign on the front of the building. The hanging sign is not well known at the moment, but the other signs are already have been on site previously. So this is just a new logo, recommended for approval.
Okay, members will have received an additional copy of this, and I'm told that there was a typo error, so if we can just ask you to cover that, please.
Yeah, at the moment there are two board signs on the front, which so this is freestanding signs on the page. So one is located to the north of the site, one to the south of the site. The proposals are ready to replace one. There's only one board sign here, which is the north of the site. So there was an error in the original report, there was two signs, and there's initially one board sign.
Any comments?
Yeah, they don't
make
sense.
Was that you want to move approval? Okay, are there any comments relevant to the planning application?
I'm not going to go into the issues when we're at the cost of all night. It's a use that's well established in that area over a number of years now, so I'll be approved.
Okay, Steve's moved approval. Do we have a second there? Thank you. Pat, all those in favour of approval? Those against? Okay, that's carried. Thank you very much. Okay, if we can now move to agenda item 13, pages 79 to 100 in your pack. This is asking members, bringing to members' attention planning applications decided on delegated powers between the dates of the 6th of February and the 12th of March. Are we happy to approve those?
We have been told by the call that it should be what they say handed down shortly.
Okay,
there being no any other business, I now declare the meeting closed and thank you for your contributions.
Thank you, Chair.